Right. So what we just discussed, in the previous lecture, where we considered optimizing a differentiable objective function non-linear with respect to constraints which are linear equality, we can now generalize it where we have objective function which can also be non-linear, and the equality constraints are also non-linear here. So you have m equality constraints, h1 of x equal to 0, h2 of x equal to 0, and so on. So I am talking of now minimize f of x subject to constraints h1 of x equal to 0 and so on, h2 of x equal to 0 and so on up to hm of x equal to 0. So this is the kind of problem that I am talking of now here. And for this problem, we can very similarly write the optimality conditions, and that theorem is actually called as the Lagrangian multiplier theorem. So what you actually do here is that you first write a Lagrangian function. Just a minute, let me change the color. So yeah, what you do is you first write a Lagrangian function x comma lambda, which is objective function f of x plus lambda 1 h1 of x plus lambda 2 h2 of x and so on up to lambda m hm of x, where these lambda 1s, lambda 2s and lambda m's are scalars. And this is like for example, you could have a constraint like e to the power x minus e to the power y is equal to 0, for example. Then that is h1 of x. H2 of x could be like log of x1 plus x2 minus x3 plus of x4 square is equal to 0. So that could be h2 of x. It could be anything. I mean, what I'm saying is these are non-linear equality constraints, h1 of x equal to 0, h2 of x equal to 0, and so on up to hm of x equal to 0. And you write a Lagrangian function like this. This function is called a Lagrangian function because Lagrange did a lot of work on it. He is the one who came up with this. And in fact, in his research, he said that the method I set forth require neither construction nor geometry nor mechanical consideration. They require only algebraic operations subject to a systematic and uniform course. So that's the beauty of this Lagrange multiplier theorem generalization that we are discussing. So we are given what usually I like to call this problem as NEP problem, non-linear equality constraint programming problem. So this is a problem, NEP problem, that we are given here. Minimize f of x subject to h1 of x is equal to 0, h2 of x equal to 0, and so on up to hm of x equal to 0. Now we are trying to give necessary conditions for the optimality of it. So first we write down a Lagrange function like this. Now given a x star, we want to see whether it is a local minimum or not, or rather here we are given that x star is a local minimum, and then to this NEP problem, and then we are trying to say what condition should it satisfy, what are the necessary conditions that x star must satisfy to be optimal. So assume that the Now here is an additional constraint that I am putting here. Assume that the constraints gradients h1 of x star gradient of h1 of x star up to hm of x star are linearly independent. So this is similar to, you if you recall, there I had condition ax equal to b in the constraint. So I had a1 of x transpose x equal to b1, a2 of x transpose equal to b2, and I am of x transpose of x equal to bm, and I had assumed that these rows are linearly independent. If you remember there, I had assumed that these rows had linearly independent, or in other words, A transpose matrix has rank m. So if this is a m cross n matrix, A transpose becomes a n cross m matrix and it has rank m. Or in other words, all the columns of A transpose are linearly independent. But if you look at this H1 of X as A1 transpose X minus B1 equal to 0, H2 of X equal to 0 as A2 transpose X minus B2 equal to 0, and these are linear constraints. You know, H1 of X equal to 0 is this, H2 of X is equal to this, HM of X equal to 0 is this equation. So if you look at gradient of H1 of X, that is the first column of A transpose matrix, which is A1. Gradient of H2 of X is A2, and gradient of HM of X is AM. So what we are now saying in the Lagrangian multiplier theorem is that, further assume that the constraint gradients are linearly independent. So in this particular case of what we had studied, this amounts to saying that these columns are linearly independent. So this condition is also known as regularity condition, and this is very important condition. If the constraints are linear and regularity condition is not satisfied, then there is not much problem. It only means that Lagrangian multipliers don't have uniqueness associated with it, but the optimality is still valid. But if the constraints are non-linear and this gradient vector, this gradient vector H1 of X, H2 of X up to HM of X, if this matrix, if these are not linearly independent, in other words, rank of above matrix, this is a n cross m matrix, if above matrix is not m, then this Lagrange multiplier theorem cannot be applied. Then our Lagrange, then our Lagrange multiplier theorem is not applicable, and we need to check optimality from a bottom-up approach. You don't have any tools available here. You have to do your own research and check the optimality. I just call it as bottom-up approach. And there is no, you can't top-down descend by saying, okay, apply this theorem. These necessary conditions are satisfied. Okay, fine. Now let's see if I can apply some set of sufficiency conditions. These are also applied. I am at the optimal. Or necessary conditions are satisfied, it may be an optimal. Or necessary conditions are not satisfied, then it is definitely not an optimal. So you don't have that standard recourse if the regularity conditions are not satisfied. So every time you apply a Lagrange multiplier theorem, first thing you should check before you apply whatever follows is that these constraints are regular, which is that this matrix made out of this has a full column rank. Okay, so let's come back. We are given a problem: minimize f of x subject to the constraints h1 of x equal to 0, h2 of x equal to 0, and so on up to hm of x equal to 0. And we are assuming that the constraint gradients are linearly independent. In other words, the regularity condition is satisfied. Then there exists a unique vector of Lagrange multipliers lambda 1 star, lambda 2 star, up to lambda n star, such that this is actually saying that such that x star lambda star is a stationary point of the Lagrangian function. So this is what we are saying now here is that first step is so what is my problem? Minimize f of x subject to h of x equal to 0, and there are m equations here. Okay, then next step, I wrote a Lagrangian function which is f of x plus sigma I equal to 1 to m lambda I x hi of x. Now the optimality is just requiring that lambda of the gradient of the Lagrangian function with respect to x at x star lambda star is 0, and gradient of Lagrangian function with respect to lambdas also is 0. In other words, optimal point is the stationary point. Optimal point is the stationary point of the Lagrangian function. Alright, so this statement is analogous to the zero gradient condition. What is the zero gradient condition? Was of gradient of f of x of star should be equal to 0. So this statement is analogous to the zero gradient condition of the unconstrained minimization problem, is it not? So that's, instead of in the unconstrained minimization problem, we had minimize f of x equal to 0, and the necessary condition was that assuming differentiability was that gradient of f of x of star should be equal to 0. Instead of that, now here with nonlinear equality constraints present, we wrote a Lagrangian function first, and then we set when we take the gradient of this Lagrangian function here with respect to, for example, x1, all right, and set it to 0. So what do we get? We get delta f of with respect to x1 plus sigma lambda I stars delta hi with respect to x1 to be equal to 0, and so on up to delta h with respect to xn equal to 0 would imply that all of this to be evaluated at x star, of course, एक्स एन प्लस सिग्मा लामड़ा आई स्टार आई इज इक्वल टू वन टू एम आई इक्वल टू वन टू एम लामड़ा आई स्टार एच आई विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू एक्स एन शुड बी इक्वल टू जीरो. सो इन अदर वर्ड्स इफ यू पुट इट इन अ मेट्रिक्स नोटेशन देन दिस इज द दिस पुट टूगेदर विल बिकम ग्रेडियंट ऑफ f of x of star and each of this gradients partial derivatives with respect to x1 to xn would give you the corresponding gradient vectors hi of x of star and this summation should be equal to 0. So this is exactly what we have written here, is it not? So what I mean to say now, that your optimal point is definitely stationary with respect to the x variables. Now when you take partial derivative of the Lagrangian function with respect to these Lagrangian multipliers lambda 1 lambda 2 to lambda m, then what do you get? Take for example that you take partial derivative with respect to lambda 1 and set it to 0, then it basically means that h1 of x star should be equal to 0. Now you take partial derivative of Lagrangian multiplier 2 with respect to 0, then it says h2 of x of star should be equal to 0, and so on up to when you take with respect to lambda m partial derivative and set it to 0, it means that hm of x of star should be equal to 0. So therefore this only means that x star, the optimal, should be a feasible point. It doesn't say anything more than that. So this is somewhat trivial, you know. We don't emphasize this part so much because our x star, when we say that let x star be the optimal of the NEP problem, it has to be a feasible point. So this only says feasibility, but overall we are looking at stationarity of the Lagrangian function both with respect to x variables and the lambda variables. So now let's come back to what this proposition is saying. Let x star be a local minimum of f subject to h of x equal to 0 and assume that the constraint gradients are linearly independent, then there exists a unique vector of Lagrangian multipliers such that it is a stationary point with respect to the x variables of your Lagrangian function, as well as this is with respect to the x variables of the Lagrangian function. If in addition, let's complete the statement. Now we are coming to the second. If the function is twice continuously differentiable, then what can we say about the projected Hessian in the linear equality constraints case, we saw that the projected Hessian should be positive semi-definite. That was necessary for optimality. The same or similar thing is now stated here. If in addition f and h are twice continuously differentiable, then look at this. This is essentially, what is this? This is a n cross n second derivative or Hessian matrix of the objective function. each one of them here are a n cross n second derivative or the Hessian matrix of the constraint, and these are weighted by the corresponding Lagrangian multiplier values at the optimal and then summed together and added to this particular thing. So in other words, this is a Hessian of only when you are restricting variables to x1 to xn. So assume that now don't consider lambda i's anymore as variables. Assume that lambda i's are fixed at lambda 1 square, lambda 2 square, up to lambda n square. So look at your function like this, that your Lagrangian function but restricted by lambda is already restricted to lambda star. So it is f of x plus lambda 1 star h1 of x plus lambda 2 star h2 of x and so on up to lambda m star hm of x. Okay. This is this function is the original Lagrangian multiplier, original Lagrangian function that I took here is a function in n plus m variables. The n variables come from x vector, the m variables come from the lambda vector. This function which I have given you here is a function only in n variables because the lambdas have been fixed. So when you look at the Hessian matrix of this, okay, then that is essentially where this is nothing but the matrix of n cross n matrix like this, and this is n cross n matrix like this. So and second derivative matrices, what does it contain? Curvature information. Is it not? The second derivative matrices contain curvature information. So this matrix contains the Hessian, this Hessian of the objective function contains the curvature of the objective function. These matrices I equal to 1 to m contain the curvature information of the constraints, and when in the Lagrangian of this form here, this is the curvature of the Lagrange function when the Lagrangians have already been fixed to lambda I star. And now what our condition is saying here, if in addition f and h are twice continuously differentiable, then we must have the y transpose Hessian of the Lagrangian function with lambdas restricted to lambda star to be positive semi-definite. This is what this essentially means, y transpose Hessian of the Lagrangian into y greater than or equal to 0. This is positive semi-definite, but not everywhere, but on the restriction that the y vector is orthogonal to the gradient vector of h. In other words, I have actually done this for you, that what we are saying is, I'm sorry. what I'm saying, other way of saying it, if Z is the null space basis of let us say that look at this matrix, gradient of H1 of X1 star transpose up to HM star transpose. So gradient, this is equivalently your take from our previous discussion, take this as the A matrix, then look at Z as the null space basis of this. Then what we are saying is that the projected Hessian, is positive semi-definite. Projected Hessian should be positive semi-definite. This is what exactly we are saying. So here this this ascertains that the vector that you are considering is of the form Zx. So if each one of this is satisfied, then the vector Y is actually in the null space and can be written as Z times something. And if the vector comes from null space and it creates a greater than or equal to zero condition here, quadratic form condition here, then it actually is essentially the same statement that the projected Hessian should be positive semi-definite. So let's take now one example to understand this theorem. So I have an example: minimize x1 plus x2 subject to x1 square plus x2 square to be equal to 2. Okay. So first let's sketch and solve this problem. So let's look at contour x1 plus x2 to be equal to 0. So then that is x1 is equal to minus of x2. So therefore, if I take this as x1, this as x2, then this line is this x1 plus x2 equal to 0. So if I take x1 plus x2 to be equal to 1, that is increasing 1, then I will get some line here. So this is the way x1 plus x2 is equal to 2 and so on. This side it is x1 plus x2 equal to minus 1, x1 plus x2 is equal to minus 2 and so on. So this is how the loci of x1 plus x2 will move. Now let's look at the equality constraint, x1 square plus x2 square is equal to 2. So this is simply a circle with center 0, 0 and radius root 2. So here I will get a circle of radius root 2, which is like around 1.4 or so. So I will get a circle like this. The shape has not come out very well, but can I do something about the shape? Let me see. Okay, I don't think I can do anything much about the shape here. So what I will do, this is the circle. I can do is, I'm sorry. So I have a circle which is sitting here, and now what I have to do is I have to minimize x1 plus x2. This side is, this is 0 value, this is 1 value, this is 2 value, this is minus 1 value, this is minus 2 value, and so on. So what it means is, if I have to minimize it, I have to start sliding it in this way. I have to start sliding it in this way until I get a constrained minimum. So because this side is, the function is reducing, so I have to move in this direction. Now you can see that here this value is infeasible. Why is it infeasible? It is infeasible because, let's call it some large value, because I don't 2 is 0 to, yeah. So why is it infeasible? This value is infeasible because the circle here is not intersecting at all with this particular line. You see this separation here? So that makes it infeasible. So what you should do, you should start moving them in such a way that at least it should touch. So the first thing that I want to do is that it should touch. I should keep on reducing it until it touches. Now, when it touches, should I stop here? No, I should experimentally try to move it further down and see whether the feasibility is maintained, and whether the feasibility is maintained and the objective function value reduces. So yes, actually now I get 2 points, feasible points here, and the objective function value reduces. I am reducing the function value actually. So then why not just keep proceeding? Keep proceeding until what will happen? You will touch here and the function has reduced, and then further movement down, you create this gap again. So you create this gap again, and your equality constraint x1 square plus x2 square is equal to 2 is x1 square plus x2 square equal to 2 is no more satisfied, and therefore it becomes infeasible. So this point where it touches the objective function is just touching the circle, this is where you have to stop. So in the retrospect, you can see that this point is the maximum and this point is the, in retrospect, you can easily see that this point is going to be the maximum. There are two touching points here. One corresponds to the maximum and another corresponds to the minimum. Now, so very clear to you now that x star should be minus 1 and minus of 1. And now if you look at the gradient of the objective function, what is the gradient of objective function? It is 1, 1, and what is the gradient corresponding to the circle? It is 2x1, 2x2. In general, this is what is 2x1, x2, and if you evaluate at x star, the minus 1, minus 2, it becomes minus 2, minus 2. So what does that mean when you look at the Lagrangian multiplier theorem here with there is only one constraint? The lambda takes the value of minus of half, sorry, lambda will take the value of plus of half. So 1, 1 plus half of minus 2, comma minus 2 becomes 0, 0. So this is exactly what we are saying, and it actually means that this what it actually means is that the cost gradient of f of x of star is normal to the constraint surface and therefore collinear with the constraint gradient. So this constraint gradient is, where is the direction of the constraint gradient? The constraint gradient here is in this direction. This is also collinear with respect to, it's the other way around. The normal is, this is delta f of h, f, this is delta x and h, and together they are collinear, and this is what exactly that collinearity condition comes out to be. Now, what about regularity here? The regularity here is quite straightforward. There is only one constraint. At x star, it takes -2, -2 vector. So, since this vector is a non-zero vector in R2, and there is only one vector, but automatically it is linearly independent. And hence, the regularity condition is satisfied. Now let me give you one example to bring out that there can be problem if regularity condition is not satisfied. So let's look at the example 3.1.1 of Bertsikas, which brings out the problem with Lagrangian multipliers. So I will consider objective function f of x as x1 plus x2. This is to illustrate problem if regularity condition is not satisfied. So I have a function x f of function f of x1 plus x2, so basically sliding line here, subject to the nonlinear constraints, two of them I have. H1 of x is equal to x1 minus 1 whole square plus x2 square minus 1, which is equal to 0, and h2 of x as x1 minus 2 whole square plus x2 square minus 4 to be equal to 0. So let's look at the first constraint, what our first constraint is. So the first constraint is a circle, okay? I can write this as x1 minus 1 whole square plus x2 minus 0 whole square is equal to 1 square. So therefore, it is a circle with center 1 comma. This has not come out to be that good a circle. You can see that I won't have made probably a good architect. My drawing is so bad. Anyway, let's look at the second constraint, h2 of x equal to 0. So now what do I have here? x1 minus 2 whole square plus x2 minus 0 whole square is equal to 2 square. So I have a circle again centered at 2, 0. I don't need to draw the full circle, but so sketching helps us small with smaller dimension problems, two dimension problems. Sketching helps a lot. So I have this as so this I have this as h2 of x equal to 0. I have this as h1 of x equal to 0. Now when you look at these two points, and what about x1 plus x2? X1 plus x2 are again sliding in that same way as we had done earlier. These are the loci of x1 plus x2 equal to different constant values, parallel sliding straight lines. So this is my f of x. Right. So this is my f of x. Okay. Now where question? First question. Question number one. Does this problem has a optimal, even if local? See, this Lagrangian multiplier theorem is only for local optimality. That's why I did convex first, because convex programming, the local and the global optimality are one and the same. But here once we keep generalizing things, you know, more and more, we will not be able to say directly about global optimality. We will be only talking about local optimality. Now, question is, does this problem has a local optimal? Answer is yes. The local optimal is at 0, 0. Why? Because trivial, my dear Watson, very, very trivial. Because there is only one feasible point, which is 0, 0. These two circles, they touch at 0, 0. They come and touch at 0, 0. And afterwards, they just diverge. They don't touch anywhere. After that, this circle is going to close like this. And it's not going to touch. So since there is only one feasible point, irrespective of what my objective function is, that is a optimal point. So this is of course a construed problem to illustrate the problem of regularity condition. If you have only one feasible point in real life, why even bother about optimization? You know, that's the only solution that you have, and you have to just live with it, whatever is your objective function. But here the purpose is to illustrate the optimality conditions have a problem here. Now, what is the gradient of h1 of x star at the optimal? It is 2 times x1 star minus 1 and x2 star. And if I substitute 0, 0, then where does it point to? 2 times of minus 1 and 0, because x1 star and x2 star are 0, 0. Now, what is h2 of x of star? It is 2 times of x1 star minus 2 and x2 star. So, it is going to be equal to minus 4 of, or rather, let me say 4 times of minus 1 and 0. So, question, are x1 square and x2 square linearly independent? Answer is no, obviously not. It is not linearly independent. Both of them point in the same direction. So multiply 2 times of h1 of x1 of star and subtract h2 of star from it and you get 0 vector. So therefore, they are not linearly independent. They are pointing here in this particular case in the same direction. So what happens here? That this vector is like say this, and the other vector is like this. So this vector, when it is made, this vector when it is made four times, it becomes equal to this, and subtracted it becomes equal to 0. And where is the gradient vector direction of the objective function? The objective function gradient vector direction is this 45 degree line along this. So whatever linear combination I do of this gradient vector plus this gradient vector, I am only going to cover the x1 direction. This linear combination, can it ever become equal to this gradient of f here in this particular case? No, it doesn't become. So if that doesn't happen, that means that the gradient of the objective function is no more in the range of the gradient or the normals of the constraints, then you don't have a stationary point as shown here, because this does not have a solution. But did it mean the point is not regular? Because what has happened, the reason why this is happening is because these are no more linearly independent. The point is not regular. But did that mean that the point is not regular, so there cannot be a stationary point. In this case, there is no stationary point. But does that mean that this optimization problem is not having a solution? No, this optimization problem is having a solution. So because the regularity in this construed example very clearly illustrated that because the regularity condition was not satisfied, I could have had an optimal while there was no stationary point of the Lagrangian function. Hence, I am emphasizing to you that before applying this theorem, the Lagrangian multiplier theorem necessary conditions, first you should check that this is actually a regular point, and after you have checked that it is a regular point, then you should check that the necessary condition stationary point is satisfied. Okay, let's stop here.